Now, let's touch a lot of bases. The first thing we keep hearing is you're going to announce in January, right? Or make some sort of decision by January.
Well, I'm going to announce whether or not I decide to run or whatever. And
what are you doing?
I haven't made that. I mean, all that's happening now is people are coming out with polls. It was sort of interesting. The one sort of negative poll I had was on Newsweek, and they put me on the cover. So I said, how could you write a poll? How could you do a poll like this? And I'm on the cover of Newsweek. And, you know, it was just one of those things. But the polls have been unbelievable. So I am going to form a presidential exploratory committee. I might as well announce it on your show. Everyone else does. But I'll be forming that and effective, I believe, tomorrow. And we'll see. I mean, we're going to take a very good, strong look at it.
Well, that's pretty close. Most people who form exploratory committees, that's that major step toward going.
Well, it's a step.
Can you say it's a major step?
I don't think I can say it's a major step. I'm looking at it very seriously. I have a lot to lose, Larry. I mean, I'm the biggest developer in New York by far. I'm doing more, as you know, from being here a lot. I mean, I'm doing more than any. I'm building 90-story buildings all over the place. And we're just doing a lot, and we're doing great. I mean, the city's the hottest city, and I'm the biggest developer in the hottest city in the world right now. Other guys, you know, they run. Pat Buchanan, what is he? You know, he's not giving up anything. What's he doing? And politicians, when they run from one office to another. It's the same thing. They, you know, answer different calls. I'm giving up a lot if I decide to run. So we're going to look at it. We're going to explore it. We're doing the committee, and we'll see how it comes out.
And the committee's going to look into all areas, talk to people,
all areas,
financing.
But really, really, the big thing they're going to look at is can you win? Can a Reform Party candidate win? Because I believe I could get the Reform Party nomination. I don't even think it would be that tough. It's going to be Buchanan, and I think Buchanan just blew himself out with the book and his love affair with Adolf Hitler. I mean, you know, how he said this is beyond belief. But I really want to see if you get that nomination, what happens from there. If I couldn't win, if I felt I couldn't win, I wouldn't run. I absolutely would not run. I'm not looking to get more votes than any other independent candidate in history. I'd want to win. So we'll see, and we're doing
studies. So this exploratory committee we announced tonight starts tomorrow.
That will start tomorrow.
And the decision by sometime in
January, February, early part of
the year. 2-3 months in there, right?
I would say about that, yes, Larry.
Okay. Are you excited?
Well, I've never been inundated. You know, I've been somebody that, for better or worse, has always gotten a lot of press. I mean, I go back to the office after lunch or after an interview like this, which is an hour, and I'll have 40, 50, 60 calls from the biggest people in media wanting to do interviews. And you know, in the meantime, I'm running a very big business, and to run it well, you want to be running it. You want to be there. So I could do this all day long, but I just don't choose to do it.
Well, let's get into some things. The Reform Party, by its name, means reform. You will be leaving, if you run this, you believe in what, the Republican Party?
I'm a registered Republican. I'm a pretty conservative guy. I'm somewhat liberal on social issues, especially health care, etc. But I'd be leaving another party, and I've been close to that party.
Why would you leave the Republican Party?
I think that nobody's really hitting it right. The Democrats are too far left. I mean, Bill Bradley, this is seriously left. He's trying to come a little more center, but he's seriously left. The Republicans are too far right. And I don't think anybody's hitting the chord. Not the chord that I want to hear, and not the chord that other people want to hear. And I've seen it. Plus, I think there's a great lack of spirit in this country. What's happened over the last 4 years is disgusting, and I just think there's a tremendous lack of spirit, and I think the spirit has to be brought back.
And it'll come through a third party.
Well, I think maybe we have no choice, and I think that the third party and the Reform Party has done an amazing job, but it's a new party. It's very, very tough to get elected from the Reform Party. We know that. But it's a possibility, and we're going to look into it.
Do you give credit to Ross Perot in that area?
I give him a lot of credit. I think he'll go down. His legacy really will be the Reform Party, much more so than, you know, we make money. He makes money. I make money. We make a lot of money. But the legacy that he's created, the Reform Party, is a great tribute to him. And I think he'll go down, and I think he'll be given great credit for it.
Pat Buchanan said he agreed with Warren Beatty. I wonder if you do. Warren Beatty said, we don't have a three-party system. We have a one-party system. We need a second party. Do you agree with that?
Well, I don't think so. I think that
you don't think the Republicans and Democrats are alike.
I don't think so. I think that their views are different, somewhat different, but they're maybe almost too divergent. If you really know the real Bill Bradley or the real Gore, you're really talking about a very, very liberal cast of characters. And I think that the Republicans are more conservative.
Is George W. Bush real conservative?
I think he's getting toward the middle. I think he's done a good job in sort of distancing himself from some of the radical views in the party. And I think he's doing all right.
You've been an activist Republican, haven't you? I mean, you support candidates.
I've actually been an activist Democrat and Republican. I support almost equally. I really support people. I support people like Senator Torricelli, who's fantastic from New Jersey, and I support, on the other hand, Rudy Giuliani, who's been the best mayor in the history of the city of New York, or George Pataki, who's been just a terrific governor and a great guy. I just support people.
The person.
I really go for the people rather than the party.
Donald Trump announcing tonight the formation tomorrow of a committee to look into the possibility of his running for the presidency of the United States. We'll be back with lots more. Don't go away. We're back with Donald Trump. We're going to be all over the board tonight talking about lots of issues as he announces the formation of exploratory committee to possibly seek the candidacy of the Reform Party. Do you have a vice presidential candidate in mind?
Well, I really haven't gotten quite there yet. I love Oprah. Oprah would always be my first choice.
Oprah,
your competitor, right?
Oprah's competitor.
You know what?
No
she's. I'll tell you, she's really a great woman, though. She is a terrific woman. She's somebody that's very special. I have not even thought about it. I guess we'll see. We'll see. Maybe that's part of the whole process.
Would she be someone? I mean, kidding aside, that you might think about.
If she'd do it, she'd be fantastic. I mean, she's popular. She's brilliant. She's a wonderful woman. I mean, if she'd ever do it. I don't know that she'd ever do it. She's got.
You'd ask her.
She'd be sort of like me. I mean, I have a lot of things going. She's got a lot of things going.
What a ticket that would be.
That would be a pretty good ticket, but she's a very exceptional woman.
What makes a good president?
Well, I think the leadership qualities. You know, the sad part about President Clinton, who I happen to like a lot, but he could have had a great presidency if the whole thing with Monica and Paula Jones, and the worst of all is, you know, Linda Tripp. I mean, this woman, where she came from, I have no idea, but this is the woman from hell.
But he didn't have anything to do with Linda Tripp.
No, he didn't, but she always seems to surface, and she's just became a part of the administration.
But can't you say, in all honesty, as Reagan asked when running against Carter, haven't you done better the last, under Clinton? Donald Trump,
you know what?
You say you've
true.
Done a
the
lot
truth
better?
Is that Rubin and Alan Greenspan and, you know, those appointments.
It's on his watch.
And it is on his watch. And the sad part is, and what I'm saying is, that he could have gone down as a really very good and
so
maybe
you'll
a
admit
great
you
president.
Have done well, and the country's done
well. I have done well, and the country's done well from an economic standpoint. There's no question about that. And now you're going to see what happens over the next period of a year. Because, you know, when the election takes place, if things aren't doing well, Larry, your Reform Party candidate has a major chance of doing something major.
Why,
so you
though,
have to see what happens.
Why does Gore inherit this character question?
Well, Gore is a man that I've said before is a very underrated man. But if he keeps going the way he's going, which has been terrible, he's no longer going to be underrated.
What's
he's
he doing wrong?
Nobody knows. It's just, I think he's relying on too many people. I think he probably raised too much money, and therefore it's being taken away by too many different consultants. I mean, everybody's got a piece of him. If he'd just go back to being the regular guy that he was, I think he'd do. I mean, he got to be vice president of the United States by being Gore. And now, all of a sudden, you have 15 people tugging on his shoulders and taking money from his various contributions. I mean, if he spent $20 million, I've spent exactly $20 million less. And
what do you want in a president? You said, okay, Clinton could have been a great president, not for the character issue. And you're saying the character issue...
I think it's very important. I mean, Ronald Reagan, to me, was a great president. And whether you're liberal or you're conservative, people really view him as a great president. He'll go down as a great president, not so much for the things he did, just there was a demeanor to him and a spirit that the country had under Ronald Reagan that was really phenomenal. And... you know, there was just a style and a class, and that's a big part of being president. I mean, that's a really big part of being president. Ronald Reagan had it. Eisenhower, I don't see him too much on lists of great, great presidents, but there was a nice time in the country. The country had a prestige, and he had a certain, you know, demeanor. He was a quality class act. There are certain people that have that. Unfortunately, with all of the scandal in the last 4 years, and what's happening with Gore is he's really tainted by it, and he's probably the last one to be involved in that kind of a scandal. But he's still tainted by it.
So
it's a tough
fair
problem.
Or unfair, it's a fact.
Well, I mean, if he were really on his game, he'd get one of his senator friends to go and run against Bradley and him so that you could divide up the anti-Clinton / Gore vote, and he'd get in very easily,
get
I
somebody
suspect.
Else
at least
to
he'd
come
get the nomination.
Strategy.
Well, no, it has to be strategy, because it's not that Bradley's good. Bradley's not great. I know Bradley very well from New Jersey. I think I'm the largest employer in the state of New Jersey, and I know Senator Bradley. And, you know, he was going to be thrown out of office. This guy was not going to be reelected. And then he made the statement that I'm going not to run, and the Senate is a terrible place, and everybody in the Senate said, it wasn't that he didn't want to run. The guy was going to lose. He was going to lose badly.
Well, Perot told us back in 92 the kind of president he would be if elected, that he would be decisive, he would be uninterested in pomposity, he would be at work at 8 o'clock in the morning. These are things he would do. He didn't like, he's not a big ribbon cutter. What kind of president would Donald Trump be?
Well, again, all those things are fine, but, you know, again, you go back to Reagan, and there is a certain pomposity, and there was a certain ribbon-cutting stature that is important for the president. I think that the whole style and look of him was just really...
Are you saying that's the kind of person you want to be?
Well, I don't say that, and I don't like to be compared to anybody, and maybe it would be unfair to them, to be honest with you, but the president has to be a great leader, and you have to lead by example. But you need leadership in this country, and we're just not having it right now. And this is going to be Gore's problem, because he is very much associated with four very ugly years, despite an economy. I mean, if you had a bad economy at this point, it would be a disaster out there. But you do have the one thing, you have a good economy.
We'll be back with lots more of Donald Trump. Don't go away. State. Hillary's here. They're going to move to New York. You live here. They're going to run. Did they get a good deal on that house?
I mean, they really got ripped on the house. The house ripped? Is right next to one of my golf courses. And, you know, I just wish I could have maybe represented him in buying the house and her, because I think I could have saved him about $600,000 or $700,000.
That really, much?
They really paid a high price. It's good for the neighborhood and it's good for the area and everything else, but they overpaid for the house. One of my people who actually runs my golf course, which is literally a couple of minutes away from where they're living, came up and said, why did they pay so much for that house?
Everybody that was the asking price, right? $1 million?
Yeah, well, the asking price doesn't mean that's what you pay.
I know.
I mean, the asking price could be a lot different from what you end up paying.
Why is it?
I really wish I could have represented them on the purchase of that house.
They represent.
I will tell you, their representatives did a very bad job. Very bad.
Did they get good financing, at least?
Well, the financing looked good. Somebody was going to put up the money, but I see that fell through.
What do you make of the Hillary Giuliani? I know you're a big fan of Giuliani. But
I am, and I like her very much. But I think Rudy, and as I said before, he's been the greatest mayor in the history of the city of New York. The city is the hottest place in the world, and that's why, you know, I'm so honored to be doing so well and to be the biggest developer in the city. But he really helped the city, and he's been a great mayor. And people, maybe some people don't like him, and some people love him totally. I happen to be in love because the guy, not because I love Rudy, because he's done an incredible job. And I think it would be unfair if somebody did that kind of a great job and then for the next office got rejected.
So if you're on the Reform Party ballot, Trump, Winfrey, whatever, whoever is, you're on the Reform Party ballot in New York, you would publicly endorse Giuliani.
Well, he's the best. I mean, he's just done a great job.
How can a Reform Party president lead when nobody in the House or Senate is in his party?
Well, maybe I'll have to go around and hire some of the lobbyists that I use already in Washington. They've done a very good job for me. I think I could probably do very well.
No,
you know, I'm a very big contributor, by the way. I'm a very big contributor to the various people and over the years. Never did I think my contributions would go toward helping me getting votes as president, okay?
So are you saying you could bring them together?
I think I could bring them together.
You could call up the congressman who you contributed to.
Excuse me, I've been friends with these guys for years. Most of them, I mean, I know so many of them, and so many of the senators.
You contributed to their campaign?
I've contributed. I think I'm like the largest or one of the largest contributors. I'm maxed out
every year. So as president, you could pick up the phone on a health bill and say, Senator so-and-so, remember I gave you?
I've been dealing with these people for years.
No, I mean, is that part of the
game? And I haven't done so badly with them. I mean, in all fairness, you know, they're wonderful people as far as I'm concerned. I've done very nicely. And I've been dealing with them for years, and I would be able to bring them together. I have no doubt about that.
Patients' Bill of Rights. You mentioned health care is one of the social issues. You for it?
I think you have to have. And again, I said, I'm conservative. Generally speaking, I'm conservative and even very conservative. But I'm quite liberal and getting much more liberal on health care and other things. I really say, what's the purpose of a country if you're not going to have defense and health care? If you can't take care of your sick in the country, forget it. It's all over. I mean, it's no good. So I'm very liberal when it comes to health care. I believe in universal health care. I believe in whatever it takes to make people well and better.
So you believe, then, it's an entitlement of birth?
I think it is. It's an entitlement to this country, and too bad the world can't be, you know, in this country. But the fact is, it's an entitlement to this country if we're going to have a great country.
So you before this measure? Currently.
I am before whatever it takes. We have the money. The fact is that the world is ripping off this country. Germany is ripping us off big league. Saudi Arabia is ripping us off big league. France, I mean, they're the worst team player I've ever seen in my life. You look at what's happened. Japan for years. I mean, we're like a whipping post for Japan.
But you can't, as president, run again. I mean, you can't be aloof.
No, no. What you can do is you can negotiate fair trade agreements so that instead of billions and billions of dollars going out, you can reduce your taxes by having it come back in. mean, I know the best negotiators. I would put the right people in charge of negotiation. We've been ripped as a country by virtually every country we do business
with. You shared Mr. Perot and Mr. Buchanan and Mr. Nader's belief with regard to NAFTA, right? You're an opponent of NAFTA.
I am, and the reason NAFTA looks okay now is because the economy is strong. But when the economy is not strong, which unfortunately will at some point happen, NAFTA is going to look like a disaster.
And are you as much of an isolationist in that area as Buchanan is?
Not an isolationist. What I am, though, is I think that you have to be treated fairly by other countries. If other countries aren't going to treat you fairly, Larry, I think that those countries should suffer the consequences.
So this isn't fair trade. Free trade isn't fair trade.
No. Free trade is a wonderful thing, and I believe in free trade. But at the same time, it's got to be fair trade. You look at some of these. I mean, look what Japan does with the cars and the subsidies and everything else. And look at Korea with the ships and the subsidies they give. I mean, it's very unfair to this country. What is happening throughout the world in a business sense is very unfair. We could reduce taxes and take care of health care, and it would be beautiful, and you'd have plenty of money left over.
Talk about honesty in the presidency with Donald Trump right after this. Donald Trump, honesty. Carter once said, "I'll never lie to you." Would you say that to the American people?
I would never lie. I one of the things that people do get, if I ever decide to do this, which is really who knows, but they've known me for a long time. I've been really a public figure for a long time. I mean, I think everything is known about me. I mean, it's...
Yes, I would say.
Interesting. I've been out there a long time.
But you could definitely say, I would not lie.
I would not lie. I would absolutely not lie. And, you know, Carter, who's a very nice man who I've gotten to know a little bit, I mean, I think he was much better after the presidency than he was during the presidency. He was a great former president.
He is,
but, and he really was. He's done a wonderful job after the presidency. I'm not sure I agreed with him at all during the presidency, to be totally honest. But he was an honest guy, and in that sense, I think we had a man who at least we said, pretty honest guy.
Do you think being in gaming could hurt you?
No, I own casinos. I'm the largest, by far the largest, person in Atlantic City, which is actually doing more business now than the entire Las Vegas Strip, which surprises people when they hear it. We're actually doing more business, and I have a big percentage of that market.
Atlantic City does better than Vegas?
Atlantic City does more business than the entire Las Vegas Strip, which very few people understand, very few people know, but it's really big.
I mean, more dollars go in there.
More dollars go in there than go into the Las Vegas
Strip. But more building goes into Las Vegas.
Well, more building. They keep building and building, but Atlantic City does more business.
But do you think the term gaming, which is gambling, will hurt you?
No, I don't think so at all. And certainly my business, again, in New York, I'm very large, to put it mildly. And in Atlantic City, I'm very large. And I'd obviously have to do something with a trust where I put my businesses into a trust, at least during this term.
Are you going to be one-term president if you're in?
Well, I think you have to solve the problems, and I believe in it. I'm not sure I believe in it that strongly, because ultimately the term limits are imposed by the people. If they don't like the job you're doing, they vote you out. But I do like the concept of one term. I want to run one term, and I want to do the right job. Straighten out Social Security, get the trade deficits in order, and lower taxes.
Well, a businessman president, pluses and minuses. There have to be some minuses, right? You got to stop thinking profit and loss. A government is not in the bottom line business.
Well, I'm tired of politicians being president because I see the lousy job they do, and I'm just tired of it, and I think a lot of other people are. And, you know, you can do a great job as a businessman. Nothing wrong with if Jack Welch, who runs General Electric brilliantly for 22 years, I mean, he should be a president. He should be president. He's great. Now, he wouldn't run. He wouldn't want to run. But he's a brilliant man who's done an amazing
job.
He'd be a fantastic president.
Esquire magazine did an article years ago called 100 People Who Could Be Great Presidents Who You May Never Have Heard Of.
That's true.
And their point was that people who can lead executives well, or great lawyer, Edward Bennett Williams might have been a great lawyer.
Absolutely, he was a great guy.
Who show leadership ability. But we don't know the nitty. For example, you and Kosovo, would you have done what Clinton did?
Well, I would have done it a little bit differently, and I know this would sound terrible, but look at the havoc that they've wreaked in Kosovo. I mean, we could say we lost very few people. Of course, we had airplanes 75,000 feet up in the air dropping bombs. But look at what we've done to that land and to those people and the deaths that we've caused. Now, they haven't been caused with us and the Allies because we were way up in the air in planes. But at some point, you had to put troops in so not everybody could go over the borders and everything else. And a lot of people agree with that. Now, would people have been killed? Perhaps more. But at least, ultimately, you would have had far fewer deaths, and you wouldn't have had the havoc and the terror that you've got right now. So, you know, I don't know if they consider that a success, because I can't consider it a success.
You don't.
They bombed the hell out of a country, out of a whole area. Everyone's fleeing in every different way, and nobody knows what's happening, and the deaths are going on by the thousands.
How well, business-wise, do you delegate?
I think I delegate pretty well. I mean, I have a great team in New York. I mean, I have just an amazing team in New York. My casinos in Atlantic City are number one. Trump Taj Mahal is number one by far.
The president has to be able to do that.
No, well,
your manager of your hotel can make a decision today.
You know,
he doesn't have to call you on it.
I know the smart people. I really know the smart people. I deal with the smart. I know the smartest people on Wall Street. And I will say that Alan Greenspan has done an amazing job. He's been great at what he's done.
You'd reappoint
and
him?
I would reappoint. I think he's a terrific guy. A lot of that's confidence. You know, you have confidence in Greenspan. People had confidence in Volcker, in all fairness. I mean, a lot of that position is confidence. When he speaks, you have confidence. It's good. He knows what he's doing.
Our guest is Donald Trump, announcing tonight the formation of a presidential exploratory committee. This is Larry King Live. We'll be right back. We're back with Donald Trump. By the way, you mentioned the golf course. Can the Clintons play there?
I'd love to have it. It would be my honor. They're only a few minutes away in their new house, and it will be my honor to have the president. But it is pretty sad when you think. The president of the United States will be out of office fairly soon, and he can't get into a golf course in Westchester. Okay, now Westchester's tough, and it's tough to get in. I don't know. I mean, why? Because of the scandals is why. I mean, why? Because he's just having a hard time getting in. He can come into my
president.
He can come
into
my
golf club.
It's pretty sad. Right. He can come into my golf
club. Can you be president and, honestly, you're president, and not think about the Trump building at the General Motors site, and not think about how did Atlantic City do today, because you got to divorce yourself.
Really,
we know how much you love.
I love real estate. I love buildings. I'm building the tallest residential tower in the world right opposite the United Nations now. I love it. I love going there. I love being with the workers. I love walking in the concrete. I mean, it's hard to believe. And those are the people that vote for me, actually, the people building those buildings, all of those buildings, all over the country. I mean, the workers are the ones that really like me. I've often said the rich people hate me and the workers love me.
But
now, the rich people that know me like me, but the rich people that don't know me, they truly dislike me.
But do you suddenly not have an interest in that?
Look, I guess you always have an interest in the sense that you love it. I love it aesthetically. I love building great buildings. I own the General Motors building.
I know, but can you suddenly say, because as president, you have to put some of that in trust, right? I mean, can you call every day and say, how's the 14th floor?
I guess the answer is I wouldn't be doing it. I'd put it in trust, and I'd just say, lots of luck. And, you know, frankly, it would do very good. I mean, I have the best locations. I have the best buildings. They'll do fine. They'll do fine without me.
There's a lot of jokes about your ego. Should a president have an ego?
I think you have to have... I don't consider myself to have a big ego. The fact is, I've never, however, met a person who's successful who didn't have an ego or a fairly substantial... There's nothing wrong with having...
You express it a lot.
I don't even express it. I mean, I put my name on buildings because it sells better. I don't do it because I need that. I mean, I get more per square foot in New York than anybody else by far. If you build a building here and I build a building there, and not to use you, but I will get substantially more per square foot in that building than the person building the building across the street for almost the same building. Now, it's not almost the same building. I build a better building. I use better finishes. It's just a better product, but I get more than other people. So I put my name on and people say, oh, gee, put his name on. The General Motors building is an example. I'm partners with Conseco, a great Steve Hilbert, a great insurance company. They're so happy. I mean, we're getting numbers that nobody
ever believed. They don't want the Conseco building.
No, because they know the Trump factor. I mean, the Trump factor, because they want to make money.
So we'll have a Trump White House.
No, I won't go there I promise. I pledge on your show. That's the second thing I pledge on your show. I will not rename the White House.
We will not have a First Lady. Who will be? I'm thinking ahead. Who's in charge of social affairs?
Well, we could have one in 24 hours. We actually could. It'd be very easy.
There's a line out there?
No, but we could have one quickly.
Are you telling us something?
No, not at all. But I'm saying if it was a prerequisite, 24 hours, it's done.
A single
first
president.
Of all, you don't know that there wouldn't be a first lady.
Well, as of
you
now.
You just don't know. As of this moment, there isn't. But you don't know that. I don't know that it's that necessary. I think that nowadays a lot of things have changed so drastically over the last... I mean, Gary Hart, in all fairness, somebody was sitting on his lap, and he was run out of office like a dog. And then you go through the whole Clinton thing, and it's like, this is major league stuff.
So you don't think it matters where
it
used to work?
I don't think it matters at all. I have some really fantastic... I've had over the years some really fantastic relationships, and... with some really spectacular women and wonderful women and nice women. And, you know, I don't think it matters, but, you know, you never know what happens.
Perot used his own money in the main. What about dollars and Trump?
Well, I'd use my own money if there were matching funds. If there's government subsidy, you always take it because you don't want to be a total schmuck. I mean, you're dealing with Republicans, you're dealing with Democrats. They've been entrenched for so long, for hundreds of years. They get all sorts of, you know, I mean, the big problem the Reform Party has is that no matter who runs for office, there are certain Democrats that will just vote Democratic. It doesn't matter if they like the candidate. And you're talking about 20-25%. Right. Same thing with the Republican Party.
So you
have to take every advantage you can get because it won't be easy. And again, I wouldn't run if I didn't think I could win the election. I wouldn't run just to get 21% of the vote and say I got more votes than anybody. It wouldn't do it for me.
How about campaign finance reform?
I think nobody knows more about campaign finance than I do because I'm the biggest contributor.
Okay, but what about reform?
Does it need reform?
You're the reform party.
It's a very complex thing. As an example, I'm allowed to give $1,000 to every senator, right? Do you know how little that is? This was 20 years ago, $1,000. Now, I love it because, you know, I'm capped out at $1,000 per senator, and they all love me for it. You know, I give them $1,000, it's great.
Soft money, hard money, PAC money.
You have other ways. But the one thing I feel strongly about, you know, I've heard Bradley and others talking about the government should pay for the elections, and I totally disagree. If you like a candidate, you should be able to contribute to that candidate. Now, they should let it be known that you're contributing. But you should be able to contribute and help that candidate. Otherwise, you're taking away the whole American system.
But as someone said, don't you? That may be true, but don't you think if I give you $1 million, you owe me something for that?
You know what? That's true. But I'll tell you, it gets a lot tougher when you have to announce, perhaps on the internet or in various forms of whatever announcement, that so-and-so gave a lot of money to such-and-such a candidate. Then it's a lot tougher. I mean, I had Ed Koch tell me that he can't do something for me because I was a contributor to his campaign. And I never liked him after that, to be honest. I said, you mean I would have been better off being an enemy? He said, well, I don't know how you... I said, you mean I contribute to your campaign and now you can't help me with something because I was a contributor? I'm much better off not contributing. So there is that.
We're going to ask Donald Trump in a minute about guns and tobacco after this.
If you could take the guns away from the bad guys, and there are plenty of them out there, I'm all for it. But you can't. Now, if you have a law that says no guns, the people that are law-abiding are going to go by that law. But the bad guys aren't, so they're going to have all the guns and the good guys aren't. It's
but
very simple.
Countries that have that don't have gun killers.
Well, countries that have it don't have as many bad guys as us, okay? I'll tell you what, you take a look. I mean, what we have now with guns is not that I'm a big fan at all.
You agree with the NRA?
I don't agree entirely, but I do agree that you should have the power to have a weapon because other people do, and other people are not necessarily the nicest people in the world.
And how people get the guns, you don't
favor
easy.
I favor you have to go through a process, but the fact is that the bad ones already have them, and they're not going to go through a process either. They're not going to go through any process. Look, there's nothing I like better than nobody has them. But that's not going to happen, Larry. So as long as that's not going to happen, I say you have to be able to have a gun.
Government's suing tobacco. States have sued. Tobaccos have already done deals. The gun dealers are doing deals, too. Gun manufacturers are doing deals with states. Would you come down tough on tobacco?
Well, I'd come down, but I'd also come down tough on alcohol. I don't know why everyone's suing tobacco, which is terrible, and I love that they're suing, and I love that they're paying a big price. But why aren't they suing the alcohol companies? Because alcohol, I mean, I lost a brother to alcohol. I've never had a drink in my life because of the fact that I had a brother that had a problem with alcohol.
Really? Is that why you don't drink? I know you don't drink.
I don't drink for that reason. I mean, I had a fabulous brother, handsome, brilliant, just the nicest guy in the world, much nicer guy than me, to be totally honest with you. I mean, the guy was great.
But he
got into the alcohol stuff, and it really destroyed his life. And he was just a great guy. He was 10 years older than me. And he was just a great guy. And
I'd
like to see the same thing happen to the alcohol companies.
But they are taxed. They're taxed.
No, they're taxed. I'd like to see them sued. You know, I don't know. I hope a lot of lawyers are watching tonight. Why is it that everybody is suing the tobacco companies and nobody sues the alcohol companies? I mean, you have the car crashes and the kids that get killed by some drunk that's, you know, riding on the road. It's just terrible. So I would like to see something happen with alcohol.
And how about tobacco, though? Would you be tough on that?
I'd be very tough. I think tobacco's terrible. I mean, I have friends that are smart and tough, and they can't stop. It's a terrible drug.
It is a terrible drug.
How about allowing
the Food and Drug Administration to control it, which the Supreme Court is going to listen to? Listed as a drug.
It should be listed as a drug, obviously. I mean, when I have friends that are the toughest, smartest people you'll ever meet, and they can't stop smoking, they start shaking if you tell them they can't have a cigarette. I've had them in the house. I say, do me a favor, don't smoke in my house. And you see these tough guys start to shake like babies. I've never seen anything like it. So it's a terrible drug, and it ultimately destroys your lungs and destroys your insides, and there's no question about it. It's inconceivable why people start smoking, but they do.
How is your health?
Well, I think my health is very good. And as far as that, I've never had a cigarette. I've never had a glass of alcohol. I've never had a cup of coffee. I mean, coffee's not the greatest thing in the world.
Do all candidates owe us their medical reports?
I think so. I think you don't want to get into a situation where you elect someone and then you find he's terminally ill and he'll be in office for about 3 more months. You know, I think that...
It might have happened with Senator Tsongas.
Well, that could have happened with Senator Tsongas. And if you look at what happened, it would have, you know, it would have been very tragic. And he was a good man, but he was a very sick guy. And you know, he kept running, and it was very brave. And he got a lot of votes where people said, boy, that's great, and isn't he incredible, and I'm going to vote for him. But the fact is, it would have been, you know,
so
very,
you think, does George W. Bush owe us to tell us, I never used drugs ever, or I did at one time, or what's your read on that?
I don't know. I like him, but I don't like his answer. I hated the answer in 7 years. I haven't had drugs in 7 years. I mean, give me a break. I think he probably owes it. I think he owes even the alcoholism, because alcohol...
Well, he's discussed that.
Well, alcohol is something that does recur. It can recur under stress and under pressure. And I guess probably the American people are really going to... Perhaps they'll learn, or perhaps they won't. But if he suffered from problems with alcohol...
We don't know if he
perhaps
was alcoholic, right? He might have had
We don't know, but he had a problem, and perhaps we should know that problem.
Because of the fear they could go back to it?
Because of the fear that people go back. I mean, this is perhaps not politically correct, but who the hell cares? I mean,
no, the alcoholic, the true alcoholic,
they know.
Always says I'm an alcoholic.
Absolutely.
Every day, right?
So I think when somebody's running, if there is a potential problem with alcohol or with drugs, I think the people have to know about it.
Will you be a traveling, will you be a president who's out there?
I think so. I think I'd be very open. And again, you know, I've been sort of growing up with the public. I've been very out there. As a businessman, probably nobody has been more out there than...
A lot of press conferences,
I don't know. It depends. I mean, sure, you'd have your press conferences, and I would be open, and I would be out there, and I think the country would really have spirit. I think we'd have a great spirit in this country that we haven't had really in a long time. And
that's
I think I'd keep the economy going strong and maybe even stronger, and I'd be able to cut taxes, and other countries would be paying a price.
I'm going to ask you in a minute what a president can do about a word like spirit. Our guest is Donald Trump. We'll be right back. Everybody who's ever run for office says things like, this is a great country. We're a tremendous people, although tonight you said we may have more people who use guns than other countries. But no, we're great people in the spirit of America, and we all hear that, and everyone says it. What can a president do about a country's, that ethereal word, spirit?
How do you define leadership? I mean, leadership is a very strange word because, you know, some people have it, some people don't, and nobody knows why. I mean, Winston Churchill was an unbelievable leader. Why? He was born with a speech impediment. He had all sorts of problems. He certainly wasn't a handsome man, and yet he was a great leader. Why was he a great leader? Nobody knows. He was a great leader.
Vince Lombardi.
I've always been... Vince
Football
Lombardi was a great leader. I mean, he was just a great leader. I mean, there are numerous cases, but
so.
I've always been able to lead. I've always been able to lead, and I've led with spirit. I've just always been able to create spirit. I built a great wealth by the spirit that I created.
Can you say there are people who would walk through walls for Donald Trump?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think I have people that are with me that would do that, yes, and I wouldn't want to ask them.
Now, how do you bring that to Omaha and to Lansing and to L.A. and to Dallas?
You just have to lead by example. Things have to happen that are different. It's just been dead out there. There's been something wrong, something missing. And again, Larry, if the economy goes bad... You know, we're all sort of semi-happy now. But we're only semi-happy because the economy's been pretty good. Not great, but it's been pretty good. If that economy tubes, you're going to see the most depressed country that you've ever seen.
If it is you versus Buchanan for the Reform Party nomination, and Pat's expecting to make some announcement by the end of this month, and you with an exploratory committee now with an announcement, if it is you versus him, what would be the primary issues to the Reform Party voter?
Well, for one thing, I'm not in love with Adolf Hitler, okay? That's a pretty big difference right there. I think you could probably run your campaign on that. I
mean, you said you didn't like
Hitler. I didn't like him,
okay.
And what I'm saying is that this guy's obviously enamored with him, and it's ridiculous. I mean, what he's saying, Hitler would have never attacked
Hitler's
us.
Hitler's going to be an issue.
Hitler would have gone a different direction.
Hitler wouldn't be an issue.
Us. I think it's the dumbest thing I've ever read. I don't get it.
It would be an issue? You bring it up.
Well, I think Hitler has to be an issue. Certainly, it's got to be an issue for some people. I mean, I can tell you one thing. He's not going to raise a lot of money from Jewish folks in New York City.
Would you debate him?
Yeah, I'd debate him. if it was appropriate.
What would be a major issue? Hitler is going to be a.
Well, I just think it's personality. I think he's a very. It's almost gotten to a point where I'm not even so sure he's far right. I think he's beyond far right, and then on other issues, he's just all over the place. I don't think he'll get any votes. Look, Pat Buchanan will get a certain number of votes, just to sort of correct. But that's it. He's not going to win anything. Now, if the Reform Party wants to nominate somebody that's going to get 5 or 6% of the wacko vote, they can do that. And they'll get 5 or 6%, but they're not going to win the election. Pat Buchanan is not winning the election. I'll tell you what Buchanan will do. Bush will lose the election if Pat Buchanan becomes the Reform Party candidate. Bradley or Gore, in my opinion, will become the next president because almost all of those votes are going to come from the Republican Party. Now, the people that would vote for Buchanan, probably their second choice would be Bush. So all they're doing is losing a vote for Bush, and he'll probably lose the election. But I think that the Republicans have seen in their own polls that if Buchanan gets the Reform Party nomination, it's not that Buchanan does anything great, but he takes all of the votes away from the Republicans.
Okay. For Trump to win against Bush and Gore, or Bush and Bradley, or McCain in this mix, he has to do what?
Well, look, again, you're starting off with a base that's really been there for a very short period of time.
Okay, you begin down.
You're not starting off from, I just got the Democratic or the Republican.
But Perot once led in the polls.
He was doing very well in the polls. I mean, had he not dropped out,
he might have won.
And then announced practically a couple of days later on your show. It's very interesting because I was watching that show. And I like him. And I'm watching the show. And I'm saying, I don't believe it. I think he wants to get back into the race. This was after he had dropped out 2 days before.
Night.
And, I'm pretty good at seeing what people want.
So who do you get?
Who do I get in terms of what, Larry?
Voters.
Oh. Well,
I mean, you got the Republican base the Democratic base.
I think what I get is the working base. I get the middle class base. For some reason, those are the people that really like Donald Trump. And I think I do well, and I think I get a lot of votes. But if I thought I was going to get the Reform nomination and then get 21 or 22% of the vote, I'm not interested.
Even though that would be the largest
ever. I'm just not interested. It wouldn't matter. And then you know what happens? The next day I'm back in my office.
We'll be back with our remaining moments with Donald Trump and going to read a very interesting letter Donald got. Don't go away. Back with our remaining moments with Donald Trump on this rather historic night, the announcement of a presidential exploratory committee. This letter that you got from JFK, July 19th, 99. Your father passed away when?
Right.
In July?
JFK Jr., that's exactly correct. It must have been one of the last things he did. He was a great guy. He was a friend of mine.
Dear Donald, I read over the weekend of your father's passing, and I just wanted to drop you a note. No matter where you are in life, losing a parent changes you. I know you had an active relationship, and I hope you'll get ample time to reflect. He sounds like a fascinating man from what I read in the Times. I like that he would go over
his various
work sites and pick up stray nails and return them. And clearly, he never lost his perspective. My condolences to you and your family. Sincerely, John Kennedy.
This was a tragedy that he died because he had so much going. He was a fabulous guy. I mean, he was really, truly a handsome, wonderful, great, bright guy.
Is that line correct? No matter where you are in life, losing a parent changes you.
Oh, it's tough. It's tough.
Did
my father
losing
was
your
special.
Father change
well,
you?
He taught me so much. He was just a special guy. He was, he was a firm guy, but just a special guy.
And he built homes where I grew up.
He
That's
built
where he
homes
started
in Brooklyn.
Benson
he started in Brooklyn. He was so
Trump
happy.
Homes.
He said, don't go to Manhattan. It's too tough. It's too tough. But, he was just
what
a spectacular guy.
What would he think of this presidential possibility?
Well, he was really my biggest fan. I mean, he was of everybody. There was nobody that was a fan of it. A lot of parents are jealous if the son goes out and does something
better
more.
Than the father.
I've
the
seen it. Business. I see it oftentimes where they have fights because of the sons and the fathers and the son. My father was my biggest fan, and anything I wanted to do, he just loved it. He was terrific. He never went to Manhattan. He never wanted to go into Manhattan real estate because to him, the land was too expensive. In Brooklyn, you buy it for $1 a foot, and in Manhattan, you pay $10,000 a foot. Forget it. It's the same land. But it was just a different thinking. But he was really proud. When I did these big jobs in Manhattan, they worked out so incredibly well. He was just proud of me. So he would have been the first one that would have said, boy, this is great.
Thus far, Perot has stayed out of it. If you were the nominee of the party, if you run it with a nominee, would you expect both Perot, Ventura to support you?
Well, I'd like that. I mean, I respect them both. Jesse is a spectacular guy. And as I said, Ross Perot has really left a great legacy in having created a third party, and a very viable third party.
This committee was going to look into a lot of things. You seem primed. You seem ready. It got to be this momentous for you. I mean, seemingly out of nowhere.
Well,
despite the jokes, I mean, we're not kidding here.
Well,
this is
we
the
get
future
a,
of, you know.
Yeah, the polls have come out so incredibly well. And again, that's why
Although
that's
you had
why
a bad one
happened.
Today, though, didn't you?
Well, no, they had a little bit of a bad one in Newsweek, but they put me on the cover of Newsweek. It's the craziest deal. But, I mean, the polls, generally speaking, National Enquirer did a poll that's unbelievable that says I win, that you beat everybody. And I'm trying to figure out, you know, I haven't even started campaigning yet. Now, maybe when I start campaigning, I'll do worse. Perhaps I shouldn't campaign at all. I'll just, you know,
just stay away.
I'll ride it right into the White House.
Thanks, Donald.
Thank you very much.
Donald Trump on this edition of Larry King Live.